This is a HeadGum Original.
Oh, everybody, Jake will fucking change who he is on the drop of a hat. With
That's
one
the golden mic for you. You finally stood up for yourself.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
This feeling has to last.
You're talking so slow.
Let's find another question.
Oh, you're derailing the show. This is why you've never won the award. This is why I'm rescinding the award.
It is being revoked.
It's being revoked.
Why?
Never in history has someone earned it and lost it in an episode.
I left work with one more dirty, thinking how'd I let it slip. And the questions made more questions, staring at my plaque of shit. I had won the golden mic, proving all the haters wrong. I had won it for a moment, then I stumbled and it was gone. Oh, that's just the way that podcasting's been. 'Cause Hurwitz holds all the cards and he's playing to win. The odds are stacked against me, but I'm never giving in. I will have that GM, 'cause I won it before, I can win it again.
That was a great tune. That was really nice. I liked that a lot.
That was a cover. Do you know it was a cover of? I had no idea.
No, I can't. It's on the tip of my dick. I can't get the name off. It's so familiar, but too far away.
It says Golden G-String by Miley Cyrus. That's what the email says. It's a cover of Golden G-String.
Okay, so I've actually never heard that song in my life before. Never heard of that.
Yeah. This is a Matt Kazakos, who's a writer, a podcaster, and yeah, he has an Instagram.
And yeah, he's got an Instagram. That's
a triple
awesome,
threat. Yeah, he looks like a talented dude. So thank you, Matt K, for submitting that theme song. It's not only like a theme song, it was like a full fucking podcast remix.
Yeah, that was great.
I don't remember.
It's a saga at this point. That's really nice.
I don't remember winning and having it taken away like that. I don't know if you have any recollection of that.
Yeah, of course.
Because you're in charge of it. You're the one person committee to decide who gets the golden mic and who doesn't. Right?
I remember it because it means a lot to me. And that was a history-making moment. It surprises me, or I guess it shouldn't surprise me, that you don't remember something like that because you're flippant. You don't give a shit. You're too flippant. You're too nonchalant. Why don't you try being chalant about it for once? Because it's always nonchalance from you. I like a little chalance.
I know you can be overwhelmed and underwhelmed, but can you ever just be whelmed?
Yeah, I think even keel, that's just whelmed. Oh, shit, it's from a movie.
Yeah.
I have no idea.
Clueless.
That's cool. Yeah. That I've seen Clueless. I should have known. I should have known that you'd be plagiarizing Clueless at the top of the episode.
Plagiarizing, quoting, homage, giving thanks to. And I actually gave credit to. You're the one who wanted to power right through. Didn't understand it. Didn't feel like it was a reference at all. But it was.
Yeah.
And I'm citing my sources. Yeah, I didn't try to sneak it past you. Presented it to you.
Let's see if it makes it into the show notes. I bet you leave it out.
Let's start with a health check. Let's see. 3 weeks ago, I got COVID. 2 weeks ago, we recorded together. Last week, you had COVID. Draw whatever conclusions you want based on that.
I wonder what happened. I really wonder what happened.
Now
I feel healthy. I feel good. It was a quick spat of COVID
in and out.
I felt healthy within like 3 or 4 days. Tested negative on day 5. Kept kept the quarantine alive for one extra day just to be safe. Tested negative on day six.
Nice. Yeah.
Yeah. And then here I am on the other side, feeling limber, feeling lithe, feeling good, feeling grand.
Immune for the holidays. That's the goal.
Yeah. Immune for the holidays. Immune. I think this one is actually going to take, because that was my third time getting COVID. I feel like my immunity now is
through the roof.
Good for good.
Maximum. Yeah. Kind of like chickenpox. Yeah. You can't get chickenpox twice, I think.
Right.
I remember as a kid, you get it. You wanted to like get it out of the way early. Are kids still getting chickenpox, or is that like a not an, like none of my friends' kids I know have chickenpox, but like when I was growing up, everyone had it at least once.
Yeah, I like remember when my sisters had it, that like some other moms in the neighborhood were like, can I bring my kid over? Because their kids needed to get it or something. Because it's dangerous to have it as an adult.
Yeah. That's a weird thing about
it. But I don't know. Maybe there's other immunity options for it now. But also, we wouldn't know because we don't have toddlers.
Well, I have a 6-year-old and an 8-year-old. The 8-year-old.
And I actually have a lot of godchildren. I should know. I should know better. Any of my god kids out there, write in and let me know if you've had chickenpox.
Well, they all have shingles, I should say. All your godchildren have shingles. I feel like
I got them for Christmas. Yeah.
I got you chickenpox for Christmas. Go play with that lady over there with all the freckles. She has open, sore freckles all over her body. Please. Go play with her on the 19th.
Do you remember taking like an oatmeal bath when you had chickenpox?
I don't.
Yeah.
I don't remember having chickenpox. I just remember like that was a thing. That and like lice inspections. Kids were very concerned about chickenpox and lice.
I do. I have a pretty strong recollection of feeling uncomfortable with my chickenpox. But I don't know. Memory is weird. It also could have been one thing that I like made up in my head when I was 13 that I remembered having chickenpox, and now that's what I remember.
Yeah. You know? Like I have some friends with like kids who are like now 4 or 5 now, and I'm like, my earliest memory is still not this early. Everything you've experienced will be gone, baby.
It's
gone.
All for naught.
All the sleepless nights, the 4 years of raising this baby into a toddler, into a child, will just...
Your favorite movie, your favorite blanket, your favorite toy, it is gone.
A hard reset is coming, and nothing will have mattered. How was Disneyland? It seemed stressful when you took them. They didn't want to go. They don't remember going.
Yeah. They don't recall, and they won't appreciate it. They'll never say thank you, because to them, it never happened.
It's fun to be on the outside looking in. I'm an uncle that way. All right. This is If I Were You, the only advice pod on the web hosted by us. I'm Amir.
I am Josh.
This one's kind of thematically relevant. We asked for lightning round questions, try to do some quick hits every once in a while. So we hit the Instagram story for some cues to A.
The IGS.
Right off the bat, Justin the Knot says, how do you keep active at your age? And this is something I wanted to talk to you about.
Oh, yeah.
After my illness, I felt very stiff and sore, like coughing hurt my ribs and sleeping hurt my back and all this, you know, getting older stuff that may or may not be COVID related. And so I downloaded that stretching app you recommended.
Stretch It.
Stretch It.
Yeah.
It's useful. There's lots of videos to follow. I've followed a few of them so far, but the infrastructure is very confusing to me. There's like some like sections that I don't really know what it is. It's just less like you've rested 90 days of your 90-day challenge. I'm like, I don't know what the hell this is, why it says I've rested 90 days. It costs $20 a month, so you think they'd be like really up to date, up to snuff about all the weird things that is happening on the app.
I think you can use it just for finding stretching videos loosey-goosey. You know, you're like, oh, okay, my back hurts, I'm going to do the bendy back class.
Right.
The only thing that I do, I log in and I do like my platinum flexibility course.
Right. So and that's then I just go, where like, that's where it says I'm 0 for 90 and I don't really know what like on mine it says day 90 rest day. That's what it says under platinum flexibility course.
That interesting. Like you've taken all 90. That is.
Yeah. Like I click on it and then it says, this is a rest day. And then I click on details. And for all 90, it's just rest days.
That's, I think there's something off with your
90
app.
Out Are of 90 days completed. Maybe I'm not enrolled, but it's a little. Yeah.
See what happens when you enroll.
Does it cost money to enroll beyond getting beyond?
No, if you are paying for the subscription, you can just enroll in that class.
Okay. I guess I have to then navigate the programs and stuff. So far, I'm just using it almost like YouTube tutorials.
Right.
I've done like two of them so far.
Two of them in the last 2 days? You're doing one a day?
Yeah.
Like a 20-minute stretch? What are we
talking? No, it was like 11 minutes each or something, maybe 10.
Nice. And it feels good?
It feels good when it's happening, but I don't know if I've felt the effects of it yet because I'm only 2 days deep.
Yeah. Yeah. I think I honestly started to feel effects 3 or 4 days in. But that was because I was like, I was exercising and really basically never stretching.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing now. I'm basically, to answer this guy's question, let's see, what's his name? I used to go to the gym, but now I stopped going to the gym just because, one, of COVID, and two, it's kind of boring for me to go there and just lift weights. That's not exciting for me anymore. So now I like play basketball and tennis. I play games to like incentivize sweating and exercising.
Right, that's good. And then you weren't stretching enough after, so now you've added the stretch to your... repertoire.
Yes. I didn't stretch before. I didn't stretch after. I woke up really early. I started sprinting. My hamstrings were sore, obviously. So, I'm just going to town on a rubber band that I never use for 5 days out of the week.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So hopefully this app will be another way that I keep fit in my old age.
I'm a big fan. I'm a big fan of the Stretch It app.
You have to teach me how to use this programs then, I guess.
Okay. Yeah, we can. We'll connect offline.
Please
Send me some screenshots.
What do you do to stay active in your age? It has to be at your age.
The trifecta. Yeah, at my age, I'm surfing. I'm biking. I'm climbing still. Usually, it shifts with the season. Like right now, I'm climbing 2 or 3 days a week, whereas before I was like riding my bike 2 or 3 days a week. And climbing 1 day a week.
Mm.
And also in the deep winter, I probably only surf like once a month. But in the spring and the fall, I was surfing at least once a week.
Whoa.
So.
Also activities though. Do you ever go to the gym and just lift and then leave?
Yeah, I do that a few days a week too. I like doing that, but I also like follow different workout programs or something, or like an exercise that my brother will send me. So like when I go to the gym, I try to have a purpose before I go. I never just show up and I'm like, what should I do?
Yeah. Let me lift.
Wake up, visualize the workout, be like, okay, I'm going to do chest today. So I'll do these three exercises and then this like high intensity finisher or something.
Yeah.
But I joined a CrossFit gym like last year and I still get the WOD, the workout of the day. So I just look at that pretty much every single day and then I screenshot the ones that I like. And then when I'm going to work out, I just go and I do the WOD.
What's your least favorite exercise in CrossFit? Is it the squats? Is it the pull-ups? Is it the kettle swings?
I don't like, I mean, overhead squats are really hard. I don't really like squat thruster type things. I have just like, my shoulders are tight. So I feel like, I went to the gym today and I was doing squat thrusters and I feel like I could do squats for a while and I could do just shoulder press for a while, but doing them together just makes the back of my neck feel pinched and it doesn't really feel like I'm exercising that well. It just feels like a tightness and a pinchingness in my shoulders. So I don't like when I'm doing an exercise that feels like it's
painful,
just
but not in a good way.
Yeah. Yeah. It was irritating. It was an irritating feeling that I had doing that today.
Yeah. That's the hard part of working out. You don't know where it's like, I'm sore. Is that good or bad? Sore can mean you're getting injured or sore can mean muscle is growing and you're doing a great job.
See, the hard part for me, exercising and staying active is kind of, that just like comes natural. It's like what I want to do anyway. But the dieting, that's really hard.
Because
I never prioritize. And I never really think about it until I need to eat. Like, I don't prioritize food in any way. I don't prep food in any way. And I'll like skip breakfast and then at like one, and then I've like also work a little past lunch and then it's 2 p.m. and I'm famished and I need to.
And you eat like, too much, and Jill's like, let's eat dinner at 5. And you're like, I'm stuffed. I just had a burrito and now I'm tired. Yeah.
So if I could do better at something, I think it'd be like planning out my meals and eating throughout the day and like starting with a healthy breakfast, having snacks.
Yeah. And I feel like if I had a lot of money, that would be my indulgence. Like, I don't need a really fancy car or a huge house. But like, can I spend $75,000 a year on a chef and just you make every meal for me and I'll drive a Mazda?
Yeah, you wouldn't even like move. You wouldn't even leave your house. So your chef, you're sharing the space in your like kitchen living room with a chef.
Right. That's right. You make it so that I wake up and it's awesome to eat every meal, and then I'll drive a shitty car instead of an $80,000 a year car.
It's not a bad idea. It's a solid trade off.
All right, here's a question from Alan or Alam Darkisat or something. The first moment you guys felt comfortable working on your own business full time.
Mm.
And it has to be a moment.
The first moment.
That awkward moment when you felt comfortable working on your business full time.
Maybe when we raised the first round of funding.
Oh, like 5 years in, you mean? You weren't comfortable for the first 5 years?
Yeah. I mean, like, I don't think I was ever like incredibly stressed out, but there's always like that like hanging over your head, like, you know, we had to make ends meet, and that was like and we're living like invoice to invoice. So I think that like getting the VC cash is probably the first time that I was like, oh great, I know that our business can't fail in the next
eight months or two.
yeah,
I guess the boring answer is like you're always a little bit nervous and you're always a little bit unsure. I feel like we're good at making a life raft while we're still on the ship. Like,
right,
we started the podcast while we're still doing Jake and Amir. We started Hegemon while we still have the podcast. We're never just like, I never had the entrepreneurial risk-taking atmosphere of like, I sold my house and I went all in on this thing where if I'd failed, I would be broke. I'm like, no, most things fail. I don't want to risk it all. Let's take a half measure and try to grow it from there. And if it works, then like start to like, okay, Jake and Amir is slowly dwindling down. Let's start a podcast, ramp it up. And now it's like we're in half equally and now we're entirely on the podcast. It's not like we're quitting Jake and Amir, we're starting a podcast.
We had like the IAC health insurance pretty much right up until we started the HeadGum company and got health insurance for ourselves that way.
You're going to need health insurance because one small thing costs $790,000. You have no idea until somebody else.
That'll destroy your business, getting ill without health insurance.
Don't be sick and unemployed in America or you'll just sort of die and no one will care. That's our MO over here.
Yeah.
Shout out to the Netherlands, by the way. Better healthcare, I assume, and better at soccer than us. Sorry, football.
That was sad. That was sad. Proud of our boys, though.
They did the best they could with what we were given.
Mm-hmm.
But our guys are small, and their guys are tall, and their guys are strong, and they're good at footy. And we're just sort of speedy.
They were a more mature team. They capitalized on the chances. They were clinical. They made us pay for it. And we fought with a lot of heart. It was a lot of heart. Other teams went down like we did and kind of seemed to give up. And I feel like we fought till the end.
That's nice. We lost, 7-1? What was it? 6-1?
No, it just felt like that. 3-1.
Okay, let's take a break. Thanks some sponsors. Try to make us a little less nervous about running a business, and then come back with more questions after these messages.
Yes.
Thank you to Stamps.com for sponsoring this episode of our show.
For real, for real.
I mean, Jake, you run several small businesses. You know how important it is to ship stuff.
What size did you say my businesses were?
Small. Is it not the case?
It's the case, but just tread lightly.
I shipped $480 million worth of hats last quarter.
Yes. I bought my own freaking boat, okay? That's right. I have a tanker.
And doing so would have been easy with Stamps.com, because for more than 20 years, Stamps.com has been an indispensable part of over 1 million businesses.
Damn.
All you need is a regular computer and a printer. You don't have to go to the post office anymore. Plus, Stamps.com seamlessly works with Shopify, Amazon, Etsy, eBay, and more.
Love it.
So stop wasting time and start saving money when you use Stamps.com to mail and ship. You just go, you sign up with promo code If I Were You for a special offer that includes a 4-week trial plus free postage and a digital scale.
Whoa.
At the very least, you'll get a scale.
Yeah, the scale's good.
Yeah. No long-term commitments or contracts. Just go to stamps.com, click the microphone at the top of the page, and enter code If I Were You.
Right on.
Thank you, Stamps.
Thank you.
And we're back. Jake, do you have any?
Oh, it's a little sooner than I can. Mom, I'm coming.
Gross.
No. No, I don't. Do you?
Yeah. So, did you know, and I'm hoping you didn't, otherwise it's sort of a boring segment. Did you know you can copy text from your phone and then hit paste on your computer and they're all synced up? So the Zoom link you sent me, I copied on my phone and then I hit paste on my computer.
I've utilized that before, but I was as surprised as you were, and I also had forgotten about it.
Yeah.
So I was vaguely aware. It's pretty cool.
It's oddly convenient and kind of scary. It's like, oh, what is going on here that we don't know about that I can just seamlessly go from one to the other? I don't know what my computer, what my phone, what my iPad knows. And now I can't possibly imagine getting in a computer that's not in the Apple family. I mean, this is how they get you.
I mean, they had me a long, long time ago.
Yeah. Do you use an iPad?
No. No, I don't.
Yeah. As I always said, I want an iPad.
Yeah.
I really want it.
Yeah. It'd be nice. They look elegant. Whenever I see someone using one on a plane, I'm like, oh yeah, that's nice. But like I just don't use apps like that. I
use it on your phone.
Yeah. I don't need the screen to be bigger.
And maybe when our eyes get worse.
Maybe.
We'll need like Instagrams blown up to the size of a fucking newspaper.
Yeah. But then like, I feel like I see iPads all the time with like the keyboard adapter and I'm like, oh, so I have a MacBook Air. That's really small.
That's one step too far. Yeah. Don't use the keyboard on an iPad.
Right.
The whole point of the iPad is that it's a one-stop shop.
I was going to say if somebody gifted me an iPad, I would maybe use it. And then I remembered that I was gifted an iPad and I gave it to Jill. So I'd,
well, what
I don't
about,
use it.
What about WhatsApp? Are you using WhatsApp?
No.
Because I have it, but no. I have WhatsApp for some like group chats, and then I have like iMessage for some group chats. And then I have them coming in on my phone. I have them coming in on my computer. Sometimes I have them coming in on my iPad. It is a little bit overwhelming to have three things constantly going on.
Yeah. It's not for me.
Okay, here's a question. I guess we're adults now. People keep asking us a question about being adults.
Cool.
Victor ain't no-ho. I struggle with setting and sticking to a budget. Advice?
You're going to have to take that. I was really never able to do that when I was... younger.
Do you have a budget now, or are you just like, in general, I'm trying not to spend a lot?
I don't really have a budget, and I usually, my default is to not spend any money, but then like whenever I'm like newly into something, I'll spend frivolously. Like when I got into surfing, I wasn't like, okay, so like I'm gonna set my budget and only spend this much money on my new hobby. I was like, okay, well, I need a wetsuit. I need a leash. I need a board. I need wax and I need a surf bag. Oh, I have to buy straps for my car now. And I just like did all of that without really thinking about it.
Yeah. Hobbies are expensive. I mean, honestly, the saddest / best way to save money is to make your own food. But that's kind of a sad answer. So like, you know, going out to restaurants, which is fun. Yeah. You'll be having pasta at home, which is... like $2.04, but then you have to do dishes. Mm. So you're saving $30 to $50, but then you have to cook and clean.
Yeah. I mean, I think one place where I can see a big savings is just like picking up your food if you're ordering out rather than doing like the Uber Eats or the Seamless or whatever.
Yeah, takeout is like, exorbitant. Like just for me, yeah. It's $40 for like right. Thai food.
Yeah. And then I feel like every single time you're getting to that checkout, you're like, oh, Jesus, look yeah. at this. Look at all these extra fees. And like, that's not necessarily
going to
go to
handling. The, yeah. Can I just pay for one? Don't even handle right. it.
And then you're like, oh, well, damn, I have to save money by not tipping the delivery person. So just even if you order and you can just go out and pick it up yourself, I think that's a nice way to save money.
Yeah. And then I guess in general, sticking to a budget. I guess the first step is to actually make the budget. I don't know. If you're trying to like yeah. come in at under $1,000 a month or $3,000 a month or whatever the hell, you have right. to actually come up with it.
You know, I think I talked about it a while ago, but I was sending myself emails with like links of things that I wanted with the subject buy question mark. And then I would snooze it for a week. Mm. And it stopped me from doing a lot of like random online shopping that it's so easy to just click and order something because you're like, you want it in the moment. But sometimes like I would snooze it for a week and then this like link to shoes would come up and I'd be like, oh, I don't want these anymore.
Yeah.
So that was helpful too.
It's also hard now because everything is twice as expensive as it was 3 years ago. So your budget is just kind of moot. Like if you buy sheets, it's several hundred dollars. If you buy a salad, it's $20. And then delivery is another $20. Nothing costs less than $10 anymore, evidently.
Yeah. Yeah.
Here's an interesting one. Would you rather... It's from Gabby Roa. Would you rather get castrated or have Mike Pence be your roommate for the rest of your life? So you would either go dickless, but a non-Pence life... Right. Or have Mike Pence, former vice president, mm-hmm. living with you. Like he would just be around.
For the rest of my life? Does that mean like if I live to be 80, that Pence will be yes. there and he'll be like 112?
Yeah. A nurse will just be wheeling him in and out of rooms you're happening to be mm-hmm. in at the time.
I mean, I think I would probably do the Pence... Yeah. The Pence move.
Just because you need a dick yeah. at the end of the day.
I want my dick around.
Yeah. And if he's just it. Like, if he's I there like while it. You're watching a show and he's like, I'm really proud of the work we did, you'll mm-hmm. sort of be able to tune that out eventually.
It'd be kind of interesting to talk to him when it was just us and be like, Trump wanted everyone to hang you. Was that like...
How do you reconcile that?
Right. You can't. Think he's good still, right? You can't be like, I'm proud of anything we did because he wanted you dead at the end of the term, at the end of the day.
Do we have any oat milk?
It was your turn to go grocery shopping, Mike. Christ.
Mother was supposed to do it for me.
Would it kill you to put the seat down, Pencey?
I can't lift anything. I have a bad sciatic nerve.
Well, let me massage that for you, Mike.
Your dick is already cut off. What did you do? You did both? Makes no sense.
No.
Jacob Hirschman has an interesting one. How many coins is too many to carry in your pocket at one time?
I mean, any. One, I would never.
You wouldn't have a lucky penny?
If I paid for something and I got cash, yeah. I would bring those coins immediately home and take them out of my pocket. It'd be the first thing I did.
And then where do you go?
I'm not one to just throw change on the ground. It wouldn't do that. But yeah, right. I'm not going to like enjoy having a quarter in my pocket. It doesn't do anything anymore.
It doesn't spark
joy. You can't even put that in. You can't even put it in a parking meter at this stage.
Yeah, everything is. Honestly, cash in general is starting to go away. If it's going all in yeah. your phone, then you but won't eat.
I do like having cash. I like having, especially in the city, it's fun to have cash.
Oh, yeah. Why?
I don't know. It's easy to just like give people cash.
So you got a 20 in your pocket. Who are you giving it to and why?
If I bought a drink at the bodega, I would probably pay for that in cash.
Oh, really?
This morning, actually, after I went to the gym, I went to the halal stand, Sammy's Halal in Bedford, and I got a combo plate, and I paid for it with a 20.
And he gives you $13.94 loose change and crumpled ones and fives.
And it's nice to have cash. It just feels good. There are still instances where you need it, and I like to have it. I don't like to be like, oh, well, I need to go to an ATM.
Yeah.
Because it doesn't take that much room.
Does that cart guy take cards? Or
yeah. Yeah, he takes cards too.
But you still prefer the cashness of it. You're old school like that.
I mean, sometimes when I'm in one of those like old school New York moments where I'm buying something on the street, I like giving someone cash. Actually, before my show in September at in Times Square, I needed a little pick me up, so I went to one of those like little magazine booths in Times Square, and I got a 5-hour energy.
Oh wow!
And I asked if the guy took cards, and he said no, but he would take Venmo. And I was like, okay, sure. So I Venmoed him $5 for this 5-hour energy.
$1 per hour of energy.
He gave me his name. And then 2 weeks ago, he responded, bless you. This is
it was several seconds months after, later. It was seconds after I sneezed. There's no way he would know that, right? How could he possibly?
Oh, there he is right now. Yeah, the cart is set up outside my house.
Are you sure you don't need some more energy? I'll give you $10 just to leave.
I'll castrate myself if you just get out of here.
Do those 5-hour energies work? Do you feel noticeably different?
Yeah, definitely.
Like more so than a Red Bull or a coffee?
Maybe as much. I mean, they taste so foul that like it's kind of like an instant jolt. And then I'm not thinking like 3.5 hours later, like I still have a little energy. It's more for like I need it immediately.
Right. And is it more 5-minute energy or does it actually last for 5 hours?
I think it carries me through 5 hours for sure.
Oh, wow.
But I feel like I also think you only really ever need to get over the hump when it comes to energy. It's not like 5 hours needs to be 5 full hours dialed in. It's more like I have to sit backstage for an hour and a half before I can get onto the stage. You know, I have to wait till doors are open. I don't know, the loading is done. So that was really what it was for.
Energy drinks sort of took off, but 5-hour energy like never became a real thing. Like it used to be more popular than it was. I don't see a lot of people or competitors even to 5-hour energy.
Yeah. Yeah. I wonder why. It was always a big thing for me. I always liked 5-hour energy.
Right. It's like it like trends into like the weird pills that they give you at like gas stations where it's like multivitamins or like it almost seems like pseudoscience more than like a energy rock star monster.
Because at some of the bodegas they keep it behind the counter and you have to ask them for it. It's not like you can't just like grab it. You can get CVS. A fucking monster. Yeah, you can get a like a quart of energy drink, a giant Rockstar energy. But then it's like, if you want the tiny one, you have to humble yourself.
And a condom. The condoms are not behind the plastic, but the 5-hour energy, you have to use the key to get through, slide it up. It looks over his shoulder.
Cigarettes and 5-hour energy.
Okay. More questions to come. Let's take another break. Thanks, sponsors. Come back with more cues.
Cool.
This show is sponsored by BetterHelp.
Thank you, BetterHelp.
I don't know if you know this, Jake, but life doesn't come with a user manual.
Right. I actually did know that.
Like if something is going awry, there's no like, okay, what am I supposed to do now, world? Navigating any of life's challenges can make you feel unsure, but there are therapists that are trained to help you figure out the cause of challenging emotions. And teach you productive coping skills.
Perfect.
I went to therapy and it was very helpful because, you know, I was able to talk to a non-biased third party and work through some issues that were giving me some challenges. And just in general, speaking to professional licensed therapists is a very helpful thing to do.
I agree.
The way it works is that you fill out a brief questionnaire and they match you with a therapist. They have so far helped 3 million people get online therapy. And if things aren't clicking, you can easily switch to a new therapist anytime. And yes, these are all online, so you don't have to go anywhere. You can right. talk to somebody from the comfort of your own home.
Amazing.
Learn more and save 10% off your first month at betterhelp.com/ifiwereyou.
That's right.
That's betterhelp, HELP.com/ifiwereyou.
Hell yeah.
Thank you, BetterHelp.
Thank you.
And we're back. We got one good traditional question to our email.
Mm-hmm.
ifiwereyoushow@gmail.com, of course.
Oh, whoa. So non-lightning round.
Non-lightning wow. round, yeah.
Cool.
I thought it would be fun to read this. This is a 27-year-old Canadian female who will call Sandra Day O'Connor.
Cool.
Over the past year, I have a friend group that's grown really close, and this group is made up of two couples, me and then Ted.
Okay.
Ted and I are single, and I've had a crush on Ted this whole time. About 5 months ago, we all got really drunk, and I wrestled with Ted for over an hour, mostly on our living room floor. Photos to prove it. And then she sent us some photos of them wrestling. The six of us frequently do triple dates, and Ted and I are always paired up for everything. Neither of us have dated anyone else in this time. Ted's a bit older and has never been in a full-on relationship with anyone. I'm starting to think it's because he never makes a move on anyone. He's so respectful and passive. Our other friends are desperate to match us up, and I've indicated some interest to him, his friends, but he definitely hasn't. He hasn't definitively said yes to any of them, which I know is a red flag, but he also hasn't said no.
So, these wrestling photos are so funny.
Yeah, they're just wrestling in the background. It's like a lady, one of the friends taking selfies, and then in the background you see Ted, tall, handsome guy, 27-year-old Sandra Day O'Connor, nice, handsome lady, wrestling each other.
It's very charming.
Does Ted like me? If so, how do I proceed without wrecking this friend group? Love the podcast from Canada.
Feels like things are naturally progressing as they should, doesn't it?
But it's been going for over a year.
Wait, a year? I think I was lost in the photos. A year.
Over the past year, we've been hanging out. About 5 months ago, we all got really drunk and wrestled. So it seems like it's trending, but he's one of those guys that like will never make a move either because he's not interested or because he's, you know, has the anxiety about that kind of stuff. I've been that kind of guy where I'm like, I will just, in an effort to never fail or go for it or ruin a friendship, just never, ever, ever, ever make a move. I will die moveless with this person.
Yeah. And I'm the opposite. I've ruined several friendships by hooking up with friends. So
what should she do?
I think at this point, first of all, did it sound like through that email like she really values Ted's friendship? It didn't necessarily.
I think she has a crush on Ted.
Yeah. So I think I can understand the hesitation to be like, we're such good friends. I don't want to ruin it. But if it's like, I'm part of this group, I like this guy, I'm wondering why nothing's happened, I like him, just, I say go for it. It couldn't be that bad, because at the very least, Ted would have to be like, I'm sorry I sent you the wrong messages by wrestling you.
Yeah. I don't know where you got that. I was interested. But my question is, what is going for it even entail at this point?
I mean, one, you could ask Ted to hang out outside of the friend group, you know,
just a one-on-one,
check in with him on the side. Just be like, what are you up to this weekend? If there's like a group text, maybe you just go full on sidebar and you say, what are you doing?
A tête-à-tête.
And suggest an activity.
Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah.
And then the other one is like, if you're all together and the couple splinter off and people have had a few drinks and you're wrestling, it doesn't seem like it's that hard to go from like the rolling around on the floor to maybe a cuddle, a peck, a smooch. It happens all the time in the movies.
Yeah. Wrestling is, you know, one of the main ways that romantic interests start touching each other, one thing leads to another, and then before you know it, the wrestling turns into something more sexual, sensual in nature.
Mm-hmm. What would you do if you were going to make a move? I know what you would do as you, but like...
Yeah. I think that's correct, is the first step is to text, hey, let's do something without the other six. Or when we're all hanging out, splinter off. Because like, it might be uncomfortable to sober start the day with a date. Or maybe that's what you need, right, just to differentiate it.
Yeah. At the very least, I think we both agree that you should just go for it. You have nothing to lose here.
I don't think he would wrestle you if he wasn't interested at all.
Yeah. I agree.
You don't go from wrestling. I wouldn't wrestle somebody that I didn't like. All right, here's a few other lightning rounds just to get us out of here.
Mm-hmm.
Aaron Kotler asks, genuinely, do you have a favorite quality/pet peeve about one another? So one is nice, and the other one is just this one thing that you really can't stand about the other person.
Interesting. I feel like my...
How about you do favorite quality for me, and I'll do pet peeve for you.
Oh, that's cool. I love that.
It's like compliment
I'm struggling to think of a quality.
Open-faced compliment sandwich, as they say.
Right.
Insult, compliment.
And yeah, I can't think of anything.
It could be worth. Like something, if I'm funny or smart or like interesting in any way.
Oh yeah, you're funny. Yeah, you're
oh,
funny.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Oh you're yeah, funny. Like you just discovered something interesting. No, I think that was a sample. Like, that was an example.
I think my compliment is also my pet peeve.
Okay, cool.
I think you are you're reliable and even keel. Right. And I think that's a good energy for the way that I like to work. We complement each other well. We never, you never get me like worked up necessarily. But then the pet peeve is sometimes when I'm worked up at some kind of like outside force and I want you to be mad, you don't get mad.
Yeah, I get even keeled.
You really don't. It borders on like me feeling gaslit because I'm like, why am I so upset? And yeah. Amir is not bothered.
Yeah, and I'm like, I guess I get what they're trying to say. It's just, you know, everyone's trying to do what's benefiting them and we're doing the same thing. And, you know, they're upset at us and we're upset at them.
Yeah, but they're trying to fuck us, Blumenfeld. They're out to get us, don't you understand?
We're all just trying to fuck each other, I guess.
yeah, that's it.
And Jake Steels, you're a shoplifter. Is that safe to say? You've stolen tons of merchandise, clothes, food.
Yeah.
You've pickpocketed. I'm a modern day
Robin Hood. Yeah.
Yeah. You'll take from the good and give to the bad, really.
Right, exactly.
An opposite of Robin Hood. I guess I could say the same thing for you, that I appreciate the passion and, you know, getting upset and getting emotional. But at the same time, maybe it rubs me the wrong way because it's like, you don't have to get mad about everything. You don't have to get mad about that. That's not a really big deal. You're getting upset before anything.
What the fuck
happens.
Is that supposed to mean? Like what the fuck is that supposed to mean? Like I get mad at everything?
Not everything. Not everything. I'm scared of you.
That's good. You're even keel of me.
All right. That was a good one to end on. All right. Fuck it. One more. A bird in the hand says, which one of you is the pickier eater?
Gotta be you.
I feel like it started as you and then you've trended more adventurous and now you've surpassed me and now I'm the pickier eater.
Yeah. Yeah. When we first met, I only ever had
turkey BLTs.
And I think for a long time I needed it to be, it was chicken cutlet, cheddar cheese and bacon, every single sandwich. Then I became a vegetarian and it was, fried eggplant and cheese sandwiches
and bacon.
And a little bacon.
What are you gonna say? No bacon.
Can't have a pig.
I said I was a vegetarian. I didn't say I didn't want bacon.
I can have hog.
Yeah, and I'm still like, I know I don't like this stuff. Yes, I'll try this mushroom. It tastes like mushrooms. Yeah. What do you want from me? I'm sorry. I wasn't raised to be adventurous. This is who I am now. There's no changing me. I don't like oysters. Mm. I don't like shellfish.
Yeah. Oh, that's my pet peeve about you. Oysters.
It is a cool thing to eat that I'll never indulge in.
Yeah.
Do you guys have chicken fingers? There's something cool about going to an oyster bar. And not cool if you only eat the calamari, but not the ones that are stringy, just the ones, the rings that taste like chicken.
Yeah. Ideally, most of the squid had fallen out, so it's just the skin. It's
loosely, just the fried crackling. Basically, yeah, an onion ring.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Thanks for those questions. Send more, please. We're running low on theme songs and questions at ifireyoushow@gmail.com.
Definitely do it.
We're doing our best to answer them all. And if you're ever eager, you need more of us, and I understand the impulse, the urge, the desire. Mm-hmm. We're making weekly videos on our Patreon, patreon.com/JA.
Ja.
So we're watching Jake and Amir videos, reminiscing, going down memory lane. And
watched some good ones recently. Some real, real good stuff.
I think we're at over 200 episodes of that. So there's a huge backlog. Wow. If you've been waiting and waiting and waiting, maybe now's the month to get into it.
I think so.
patreon.com/JA.
That's right.
And thank you for listening. And thank you to Matt K for this epic theme song. Let's hear it again on our way out.
Why not?
And of course, we'll be back next week. Have a happy, happy Christmas. And it's the best one of the year.
I know that was hard for you to sing.
Where is this darn theme song? Wait for it. Wait for it.
Here it comes.
Here we go. So everybody, Jake will fucking change who he is on the drop of a hat with
That's
one
the golden mic for you. You finally stood up for yourself.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
This feeling has to last.
You're talking so slow.
Let's find another question.
Oh, you're derailing the show. This is why you've never won the award. This is why I'm rescinding the award. It is being revoked. It's being revoked.
Why?
Never in history has someone earned it and lost it in an episode.
I left work with one more dirty, thinking how'd I let it slip. And the questions made more questions, staring at my plaque of shit. I had won the golden mic, proving all the haters wrong. I had won it for a moment, then I stumbled and it was gone. Oh, that's just the way that podcasting's been. 'Cause Hurwitz holds all the cards and he's playing to win. The odds are stacked against me, but I'm never giving in. I will have that GM. 'Cause I won it before, I can win it again.
That was a HeadGum Original.